Alright, so hello.
Hello.
Thank you all for coming. I think someone said that there's about two. Raise your hand if you were not here last time. Okay. Hi, thank you. Thank you for coming this time. My name is Warren Lee.
I'm Susan Shen.
We are from the Conway School. We are here working with the town to come up with some designs for a variety of goals that we have all established needs for the historical district that we are in right now. We're going to go through a slideshow of all of the analysis that we've done over the past couple of weeks, and so that you are sort of have a background knowledge of how it is we came up with the designs that we did come up with. Then we'll run through the designs up here on the screen, highlighting some of the features and the pros and cons of those features. We have about three different designs, and then we also have them in hard copy, and so we'll turn those around, and we'll give you all about 10 minutes or so to write down your thoughts and comments, and then we'll spend the last 30 minutes hearing feedback about what you do and don't like about these designs, so that we can sort of formalize a final design for you based on what it is that you do and don't like from those designs or other recommendations that you might have based on what we show you. And it looks like we have another three people, so we'll wait 1 second to start the slideshow.
And they have seats up here.
Yeah. Yes, and our clicker is not working, so I will be standing behind.
Great breeze across the front row. Don't be
So I'll be back here just because we don't apparently have a clicker that is working at the moment. So I'll be advancing this way. All right. So this is our opening slide. We are trying to create a more welcoming space with sort of the synthesis of the different goals that we have come up with. And I'm sure you all sort of recognize. Oh, and so this presentation we gave last Friday to a host of people, Susan and
Fred.
Fred came last Friday and gave us some feedback already on the designs, and we've come up with additional designs. We also had some professional planners and designers who were there. They also gave us feedback. So what you're seeing today, we haven't really shown a lot of people in terms of design, but we're giving a very similar presentation. So some of the things in here were designed for people who'd never been to Whately. We pared some stuff down because you all are from this space, so you recognize views such as this. So the request that the committee that we're working with has sort of established for us is to create a more walkable, attractive, and functional town center for both you all and then visitors who come for whatever reason. The goals that we established based on this request were to increase safety and walkability between the buildings of the historic district. That includes addressing sidewalk damage, reducing the pooling and the icing that happens both on sidewalks and in the parking lots, better lighting for that travel on sidewalks, and then some traffic calming elements. I think our last meeting we established that there's some speeding that happens through the town.
The second goal we have is to design for greener stormwater management that reduces erosion around the edges of the roads and parking lots, and also reduces the pooling that can cause slippery and icy conditions in the wintertime on the sidewalks and the parking lots. And part of the plan for doing that will be to increase infiltration of rainwater so it's not flowing on the hard surfaces all the time.
Then to improve the parking lot themselves, both in capacity and safety. Delineating spaces might help. We did explore those options. And then reducing some of the pooling and the icing that happens at the bases of a lot of these parking lots and then the back of the library parking lot.
And then to create a planting and management plan for around some of the public buildings, as well as, in particular, the historic rows of trees that line the sidewalks along Chestnut Plain Road.
And then, because this is the historic district, and you like it for particular reasons, to do all of these and come up with designs that continue to maintain that historic character that most people love about Whately. So the analysis that we did, we sort of went through a context of where Whately sits, both within the region and then the immediate area. We looked at watersheds, the tree health, and then the access and circulation within Whately. We were sort of specifically asked to, at least for the initial stage, to focus on design alternatives for the top half of Whately, because it incorporates a lot of the problem areas in terms of parking, sidewalks, it incorporates stormwater and trees. So it has everything in one. And because it's such a large district, we focused a lot of our design, and you'll see that on the top half. Everything that we've come up with and will continue to come up with will be extended to the entire district itself. Not necessarily parking, because there is no parking on the southern half, but things like the stormwater management and so forth go for the whole entire district.
So first we'll look at a little bit of the topography of the town. The historic district sits on a ridge right here at the edge of the foothills and at the edge of the Connecticut River floodplain. It gives us beautiful views looking out to the east. Here you can see the town hall on the ridge with the mountains, the foothills to the west, and then those beautiful views all the way across to Mount Sugarloaf to the east. Looking at the slopes on the more detail of the district, the town hall sits at the peak of the ridge. And then most of the area along Chestnut Plain Road is gently sloped, less than a 5% grade. And that's shown in white, so you can see it all along here. There are moderate slopes to the east, shown in gray, leading down to the floodplain, and also moderate slopes to the west, leading up into the foothills. And then there are some steep slopes, shown in the dark gray to the north along the brook. Since the slopes on the site, especially in the area along the road, are gentle, it makes it really easy to site sidewalks and parking, because we don't have to worry about cars rolling over, people having difficulty climbing grades. And it also makes it easier to manage storm water because the water isn't flowing quickly down a steep slope before we can capture it and deal with it.
So some of the regional access, and you all know this more or less, but Whately is just west of Route 5 and 91, so it provides some alternative to people who are traveling north and south if they choose so, as well as those traveling to Williamsburg and Route 9 to the southwest and other smaller towns there. This is mainly to highlight the fact that Chestnut Plain Road experiences some traffic and some speeding because of this this travel, as well as the residents within. So making designs that attempts to alleviate some of that speed going through town is something that we try to focus on.
So looking a little bit at the land use in the district, most of the district for human uses is residential and agricultural. The residential is shown in the pink color, commercial in red, and the agricultural is in the lighter green. There are some town buildings, a church, and one business. And the undeveloped lands are largely forested and wetlands. The forested lands shown in the darker green, and the wetlands shown in the blue color. And the wetlands more or less surround the district. So meeting the goal of improved stormwater management could help protect these wetlands. Looking at the buildings in the district, there are four public buildings. The Center School Building, which is currently used for the Historical Society, the Dickinson Library, the Whately Post Office, and the adjacent Town Hall Building. The Town Hall Building is currently not used for that town office, so it's been moved, but there is a proposed renovation that we need to keep in mind when we're designing in case that moves forward. The Whately Inn and Restaurant is across the street, and that's the only business within the district. And then lastly, the Congregational Church is the last non-residence building. So connection between these public buildings especially has been highlighted as an important goal that will have to be taken into account for parking and especially for the sidewalks interconnecting them.
So we went through originally and highlighted a bunch of views that you all came up with last time that we took note of. And essentially there are a lot of really beautiful views both from the road and then from the sidewalks themselves. On occasion, there are some bare dirt areas from erosion or snow plows, both at the ends of parking lots as well as along the road. So our goal is to sort of highlight the views that you all said that you really enjoyed, and then try to disguise or minimize some of those views of erosion and things that are maybe not as pleasant to see.
So looking at how water moves through the district, the historic district straddles the border between two sub-watersheds of the Mill River. These are shown in green. So all the water from this part of the district goes this way to the brook and then into the Mill River, and then from the green line over, everything goes directly into the Mill River. Both of these watersheds overlap some core habitat that was identified by the Biomap 2 study that was done for the state of Massachusetts. There are a number of endangered species that live in this district. Some examples are the dwarf wedge mussels, which is federally endangered, the winged monkey flower, which is also federally endangered, and the wood turtle, which is a species of special concern. And these all inhabit riparian and streams and river habitat. So controlling the stormwater runoff can also just help to protect these species. The other thing that's important about water in the district is that it sits on the aquifer recharge areas for some of the town's wells. The subdivision bylaws encourage infiltration basins where it's appropriate in these areas. And the soils in the district are primarily well-drained and excessively drained, although there are some areas of clay that we do have to watch out for, especially up by the library. But largely, it should be suitable for infiltration basins. So since the soils are suitable and the infiltration is encouraged in the district, it's something we should be able to take advantage of in our rainwater management plan. The existing system is a stormwater drainage system. That's shown in blue is the path the water takes. These are the catch basins along the street. The arrow from about right there, the water goes south, and then the rest of the water goes north and discharges into that brook that goes into the Mill River. There's currently no active effort to capture runoff for infiltration, although there are a lot of trees and grass that do help with that. The northern outlet is into that brook, which is in the biomap 2 core habitat, shown in green. And some of the catch basins currently are functioning poorly, which is resulting in erosion. Here you can see those stormwater running along, eroding this the grass edge instead of going into the catch basin. So increasing infiltration in the district could help reduce the load on this stormwater system and also reduce the amount of unfiltered water that gets into the local streams and rivers. Go ahead.
Yeah, so we also took a look at the trees because it is a historical part of Whately and it's been deemed as something that's really important. So mostly it's maple trees. We found some other trees along the way. But we also found that there are areas that only have one row of trees opposed to the historic double row and then other areas that have gaps. Whether that is from trees dying and not being replaced or because there are parking lots and so forth, there are periodically gaps in that double row. We also noticed, or we did a preliminary analysis of the tree health and deemed them either in poor health, fair health, or good health. That was simply done through going through and, looking at the trees. Those that were in poor health were deemed such because they had either entire branches or entire sections of the tree that were dying, or they had lots of visible wounds and decay. They were susceptible to disease and pest damage. Those trees that were in fair health seemed to be fairly healthy, but they still had visible dead branches and then some other sores and open wounds that were again sort of susceptible to that disease and pest damage. Good health was fairly simple to classify because it was very healthy looking. There was no dead branches, no apparent wounds, and the tree appeared for all intents and purposes to be very much in good health. The analysis itself didn't reveal any pattern as to why certain trees are dying or in decline over others. There was no patches that were more prominent than others. The specific cause of that decline would need to be investigated by a certified arborist. I have worked with arborists for a couple of years, and that's how I did the classification, but I'm not certified, and so some of them you really need to come in and do that actual analysis to let you know where that is happening and potentially further things to do. Despite that, many different institutions have done studies that show that specifically sugar maple in the Northeast are in decline. So any future plans that we have for management of these trees as well as planting should sort of take that into account. Research has also shown that an eight feet between trees and sidewalks is ideal if you want that tree to be at its most healthy and grow to be its largest possible self. So we highlighted sort of in yellow over to the left in areas where the sidewalk currently comes within 8 feet of the tree, sometimes within a foot or 6 inches. And then highlighted in red are sort of where the trees are within 8 feet of property lines, meaning that a future sidewalk couldn't actually go there without really imposing some damage on the tree roots and the health of the tree itself. So designing a sidewalk in our designs, we try to avoid all the areas highlighted in yellow and red. Speaking of sidewalks, you sort of know where they are. You also know that they are degrading in many areas. They're narrow, 3 feet wide, which means that they are not ADA accessible. They're not, even if they were 5 feet wide, because of the degradation, they're still not necessarily accessible for wheelchairs. and are generally just unsafe.
So we'll take a little look at parking. There's public parking located up at the center school, about four spots of official regulation size parallel parking. There are eight spots at the library, another 15 spots in front of the town hall and post office, and Whately has a private park that's unlined, and on most of the lots, the parking capacity varies since there aren't lines based on who gets there first and how they park. These parking lots don't offer enough space for the current use. Overflow parking for library events sometimes occurs on the grass out front, and overflow parking from the Whately and overflows onto the town hall lot almost every week, several days a week. And as I was saying, none of the parking lots have proper demarcation, so the parking lot capacity varies, and there are some kind of headaches with funder vendors and such as well. Most of the runoff from these sites runs onto the road and is captured in the stormwater system. There's some pooling that occurs at a couple of sites, particularly at the back end of the library parking lot, and then there are a couple spots in front of the town hall, here by the island and then here at the foot of the driveway. The town is discussing the potential for some new uses in the town hall. One of those potential uses is a 75-person auditorium. The town's zoning bylaws require that for every three seats in the auditorium, there is one parking space on site, which means that the town hall itself would need 25 parking spaces to support that. Currently, there aren't any designated spots, but again, there are room for approximately 15 parking spaces as the parking lot exists now. So if the town hall is again used in the future, particularly for this performance space, there's going to be more demand on the parking lot and less room for overflow parking from the Whately. And so we have two competing needs for this parking space that is already inadequate. So future parking designs should account for this increased use and the Whately and overflow. The library parking should be expanded to preserve the health of the grass and trees here in front so that people aren't parking on the grass or on the roots of the trees. And then the stormwater management design will need to account for the runoff of the current parking lots and the additional impervious pavement of any parking expansion.
So that was sort of what we did in terms of analysis, which is to say that the current drainage system allows for runoff, but it enters critical habitat without any filtration. The soils are suitable for that infiltration to address both the recharge and filtering out the water for that critical habitat, but not a lot is happening at the moment. The current sidewalks are degraded, too close to trees, impacting tree health, and then the tree roots themselves are damaging the sidewalks. There are pleasant views throughout town, which we are hoping to highlight, and then current parking capacity is both inadequate and at times unsafe. And then some trees are in decline, and future management, if it continues to be Sugar Maple, should expect this to continue. So the design alternatives that we're about to go over, all of them really attempt to address all of these issues. The need for more parking, management of stormwater runoff, sidewalk routes, hopefully that do not infringe upon the tree health when possible, a desire for the historic double row of trees when it can fit, and then pedestrian safety and traffic calming are also something that we really try to look at in designing these. So we're going to run through all three. Oh, first, before we show you the designs, we're going to use some words such as infiltration basins and talk about sidewalks going through the trees and so forth. So we've found some pictures so that you can better imagine what we're talking about. So we're going to run through some precedents, people who have done this before, towns who have done this, so you can sort of see what we're talking about when we're showing you a pencil drawing plan view. So the first one being the sidewalks. As you well know, sidewalks, right now, they're not necessarily located through the trees. There are options of doing it so that the trees still remain healthy, but you are maintaining that vista as well as running the sidewalk through the trees themselves.
Looking at cars, parallel parking can also help calm traffic. As people are more aware when cars are nearby, they tend to slow down. And that could also be a way to expand the parking capacity along the road that doesn't infringe on the green spaces near the buildings. There's also options for parking separated from the sidewalks by tree, which can provide shade for both of those and kind of soften the edge of the hardscape so it's not just like parking and then sidewalk and lots of concrete and stuff like that. And again, here's parking on one side of the street that allows for the tree canopy to come closer over the street from the left side there, but still provides that benefit of expanded parking and the traffic calming. And then lastly, parking lots can be shielded from negative views with vegetation. This can also be organized to capture runoff in some cases.
The infiltration basins that we will talk about in terms of trying to collect some of that rainwater and infiltrate it into the ground rather than running into the brook have a variety of ways that they can look. They can have flowers and tall grasses, they can have short shrubs, it can be just a simple 1 foot indention that is grass that you can continue to mow, that still provides a place for the water to cool and then sink into the ground. It can also be rather deep, lined with rocks, that has minimal maintenance to it, but still not grass, so you're not having to mow it all the time. And then you can also run sidewalks through the infiltration basins, that whole space on both sides of that rockway are spaces where water can infiltrate, and it creates a nice buffer in between the road itself and the sidewalk. These are somewhat more urban scapes opposed to Whately, but it sort of highlights the idea of what an infiltration basin can look like, and essentially saying that it can look like anything you want.
So there are a number of ways to calm traffic in addition to parking on the side of the street. Some of them are bump outs that pinch the road that would probably require expanding the shoulder here in Whately, since Chestnut Plain Road is already as narrow as it pretty much can be. But expanding the shoulder spaces to allow for parking can allow you to effectively add a bump out between some of the sets of parking spaces.
And then you can also use trees for that same purpose. Having trees closer to the road itself creates this effect of pinching the road as well. Whereas without trees, it looks like a much more open space that you can drive faster on. With trees and a canopy that encloses that space, it sometimes feels a little bit smaller, and many towns use that as a way of helping to calm the traffic as well. So, our designs.
This one is called Basin Bonanza. It focuses on putting infiltration bases pretty much everywhere we can. We'll start off with going through the parking. There are some expanded parking up at the north by the library. It's expanded from 8 to 11 spots. There's pull-in parking along the street to give 8 spots. 9 spaces delineated with 1 handicapped spot in front of Town Hall, 2 behind in the back, and then double row of parking here at the Whately Inn. The benefits of this, the on-street parking helps promote traffic calming. There's less concentration of parking here. There's not like one giant lot that screens out like big box store or something like that. It does increase the parking capacity. And then the parking is near infiltration basins. For instance, this one here is by the Town Hall parking lot. There are some that straddle these parking lot. This one services the library. And then this is all infiltration basin as well as here. So those are placed to service the parking lots immediately. Downside to this design, the on-street parking can take away from the view. When you look down the road, there's a possibility you're gonna see cars parked there instead of just grass all the way along. We can use some vegetation to kind of break up that view, but again, it's a change, so it's something that could be seen as a negative. This particular style of on-street parking is directional, so it could cause traffic issues. If people are coming south on the road and want to park there, they either have to hook a tight U-turn or go down here and come around. The trouble with head-in parking straight on, though, is that you end up too close to these trees, so we needed to go with a more angled design, or parallel would be another option for that space. This one has 11 spots in front of the Town Hall. You can cram more in front, but it doesn't leave any space for this infiltration basin, and it really just makes this pretty much solid asphalt from here all the way up to the front of the Town Hall. So we avoided that in this particular design. And there may need to be some review by the zoning board on the exact dimensions and availability of the option of putting those diagonal spots on, since you would have to pull out onto the road to turn around. And again, another zoning requirement that there exists in the town is that visual obstructions can't be within 25 feet of the road or the driveway at the corners. So basically coming in and over 25 feet at any intersection. So some of these trees, depending on whether they count as an obstruction or not, whether a narrow trunk counts or not, we need to check that out as well. So we add some additional trees, as shown in the circled ones. They are also highlighted with a cross in the center instead of the round dot. We do fill in a lot of the gaps that were in that row of trees. These trees here closer to this intersection may help slow traffic as you come around. That tree trunk is there and kind of comes in close to you and makes you take a second look before you come around the corner. The downsides are that the trees end up closer to the road on the west side than they do on the east side, so there's a little asymmetry there. That's primarily because there's power lines that run here and we can't get that tree canopy to come over the road from the east side. The basins shown here in purple, there's a benefit to that, especially here in that bare dirt area north of the Whately parking lot. We vegetate the bare dirt and use it as an infiltration basin, and since it's below grade, the snow plow, when it goes over top, is less likely to damage it and scrape all the grass off anymore. The basins are sized and located to catch the water flow and keep it off of the roads. And these will reduce erosion, filter the water, that is going to be an important habitat. The downside is that depending on what's in the infiltration basin, they could require more maintenance. We could make it grass, we could make it pollinator gardens, they could be bushes and shrubs. Depending on what's chosen and the look that we want, it could change the maintenance strategy that is currently in effect, which is basically, I believe, the homeowner's mowing that section in front of their property. And again, that could change the look of the street. It might not much. If it's just a shallow basin with grass, it won't change the look very much. But if something more aggressive is done, it could change the look of the historic district. And there are pluses and minuses to that. And lastly, the placement of the sidewalks. These are 5 feet wide and graded so that they're accessible. They're 8 feet away from most of the trees. To make them straight through the existing stands of trees, that has to be sacrificed in a couple of spots, because that's especially this section from the Town Hall Library, the really dense planting of healthy trees. And because of that spacing where we can do it, they'll be less susceptible to tree root damage, and the tree won't be damaged as likely as well. Redoing the sidewalks is going to dig up fresh ground and could damage the tree roots. There are options to build up to go to the sidewalk instead of having to dig in, so those will be explored. And then there are, as I said, there are some areas where they're closer to 8 feet to the tree, and with the idea of keeping these straight courses in the sidewalk so you can just see down that column of trees.
All right, so we have another design alternative called the Trove of Trees, which takes away some of the infiltration basins and plants a lot more trees in the hope to absorb a lot more water with the trees themselves and to continue that double row of historic trees. So again, there is parking. For this particular alternative, there are about 24, possibly 25 that could fit on Town Hall. 10 out front, about 6 that take up space where the current vet memorial is, which has been moved to the library, and then 8 spots out back. There's 15 spots still available at the Whately Inn, and we've expanded library, which allows for 11 as well. Some of the pros of this is that there's 24 parking spots on site for the town hall and the additional auditorium and uses of the town hall that provide space for more trees close to the road because they're further back. The cons is that you have to pave over that commons area right out here and there's much less green space surrounding the town hall itself. The memorial has also been moved up to the library, which is going to be an incurred cost. The trees on this one, there are a lot more of them. They continue the double row of trees in many spaces that it currently doesn't exist. They fill in those gaps, and then the trees are closer to the road both on the west and on the east for the traffic calming purposes. And then the more trees provide absorption of water. It doesn't allow, the east side of the road doesn't allow for the taller trees that are very indicative of Whately, so they're smaller trees and they may look a little bit different. Depends on what exactly you are trying to accomplish. And then there's less room for the infiltration basins. The infiltration basins that do exist, they still catch some of that water flow from the roads, reducing erosion, and it has a lot of the same benefits. And the con being that there are smaller and fewer of those, which may not allow you to handle all of the heavy rain load from different storms. And then the sidewalk on this particular design is also 5 feet wide. In all spaces, it's 8 feet away from the trees, which is better for both the trees and the sidewalk itself. And then it eliminates the sidewalk on the west side of the road, in between the Whately Inn and about sort of two blocks up. The reason for this being that most of the people walking to the Whately Inn or going to the Whately Inn aren't necessarily walking there and living within the district. Many residents within the district are using the library, the post office, and the town hall itself. So the library is directed to those spaces. It also provides a lot more crosswalks with different surfaces to indicate so people slow down because people are crossing there, and this is another element of traffic calming. The cons being that there's not a continuous path on the west side of the road, and construction damage may again damage some of the existing trees.
The last design is called Lots of Lots. This adds up to a little over 70 spaces of parking. The idea for this plan is not to promote this as a plan itself, but to show potential features that could be added. Starting at the north, we put parking behind the center school with a pull through all the way to Christian Lane. You might have noticed a small detail, and in this design, the dingle is
eliminated,
turning this into a T intersection to slow traffic coming around the corner into the district. That's a big change, and there could be some serious repercussions of that I don't know all the background of, but we thought we'd present that. So that parking can service both the school and funerals at the cemetery, which you've heard there is sometimes overflow and difficulty parking all the cars necessary for that. This allows for the street trees to be in front of the building parcels to continue the rows. We'll get into a little more detail on the trees later, but the lighter green are all the added trees to fill out the rows of trees. A sign is added at the Whately Inn to say that there's additional parking in the rear to help people when they come in, if there isn't a spot, to know, hey, I can go around back on that big gravel lot instead of the reflex being to come back around and park at the town hall. Maybe that simple sign could actually bring some actual benefit to moving traffic where we really want it to go. There's street parking, parallel parking here and here on each side in front of the library. It's hard to see on the drawing there. But that could also help slow traffic as you come between those rows of cars. We can include bump outs to help slow traffic down. And then we have some gas lamp lights, which aren't shown in this drawing, but will be on the printed out one to provide light for walking at night between the parking areas. Downsides of this, the center school, there's a potential it could be sold for, so investing in infrastructure there may not be the best idea. In this design, affordable housing is relocated to provide more parking immediately to the town hall. That may or may not be a possibility. It could require the town to acquire more land. There's a 30-space parking lot on somebody else's property. That's this example here. Not to pick on anybody in particular, just an example of if the town actually procured some land specifically for parking, we could have a high-density spot of parking that wasn't necessarily on the road and wouldn't impact the scenery along the roadway so much. That, of course, could impact the view for the homes nearby, as could the parallel parking. That parallel parking does change the look of the street as you look down the road, and there is some reduced capacity in front of the town hall and the Whately Inn in the interest of adding some trees here to help slow down traffic in that area near the Haydenville Road intersection.
We want to highlight real quick before we move on from this that we're not advocating all of these things be done. We just wanted to get one design up there that said there are lots of different possibilities for parking that we can explore and get some feedback about if any of these are at all possible, what people think about them. Some other things that this does is to get rid of that dingle as we've talked about, and that could be potentially turned into a park in itself. It also gets rid of sort of the danger that that intersection has posed for a lot of people for a long time. And then both that intersection as well as the intersection of Haydenville Road, the area has been pinched so that it's more of a 90 degree angle turn rather than a sweeping turn that is easy to go fast around the corners. And then there are some gas lamps at the different crosswalks. The crosswalks providing traffic slowing purposes, but also the gas lamps provide some safety for crossing. And then some lighting on the ground between the different parking lots of town hall and the library, and then along the side of the parking lots to make sure that those are still visible and safe for pedestrians. And then throughout the space, the trees are again closer to the corners of the roads to provide that traffic calming sense again. Some cons of this are that traffic from Christian Lane has to come to a stop. It no longer is a merge for either space. It's an actual stop where you have to make the turn. There's an asymmetric look as the trees on the western side again are closer to the road, but on the east side it can't be that way. So the road seems to be closer to the trees rather than in the middle of the roads. And then some of the increased lighting may disturb some of the neighbors at night. Crosswalk signs would also be, for all crosswalks, would have to be put in, causing a little bit of sign pollution. And then there's an incurred cost for eliminating an entire section of road, which you know may or may not be possible. So those are the designs we have as of right now. We are going to pass out some sheets of paper that will have all three of the designs on them, and we're going to turn these things around so that you can see them as well. We're going to give you about 10 minutes to collect your thoughts and write it down, highlight things that you want us to know. We're going to collect these at the end to take with us and incorporate into future designs. And then we're also going to spend about 30 minutes talking about it as a group. We just want to make sure that in case your comments aren't able to be heard in the 30 minutes, we still have them to take with us. We're going to try and do this as orderly as possible. So if you have, what we're looking for is essentially, well, your thoughts. I'm sure you have lots of them. Some of these are very radical changes, some of them not too much. We want to know what you do like about it. We're going to spend about 10 minutes on each design. I'm going to roll down some trace paper and redesign it as we talk about it and sort of circle things. Susan's going to take notes about what you said so that we'll make sure that we're getting everything down. So we'll talk about 10 minutes on one and then go to the next one. So we'll get to all of them. Things that you do like, things that you don't like. If you don't like it but you have a suggestion, feel free to shout it or say it softly. And we'll try to get to as many as we can in those 10 minutes. I should probably also time those 10 minutes. So we will start, let's not start with that one, let's start with this one. So this is the Trees of Trove. This one has about 24 parking spots on town hall area. Lots more trees, less infiltration basins, and we will start there with whoever has comments. Everyone loves it.
Yes. I'm unclear about how much
this one questions. Great.
Impacts the traffic issue, like the speed of traffic. I mean, the only thing that's happening in this one, as I understand it, is you're moving trees close to the road to slow people down.
And crosswalks.
Oh, crosswalks.
Without expanding the road, it's right now the road is about 22 feet across, mm-hmm. and it can't get any smaller. Mm-hmm. So in order to create that pinching effect, which is most often what people do, is they have lots of shoulders or parking, or you know, even like a 3-foot shoulder, they'll bring that in close. So it seems like the road's getting close, so people will slow down. We can't do that unless it is expanded. So some of the options that we explored without expanding and then contracting were street trees. Other people have said the same thing. I'm not sure if it does work. Some people say that it does, some people say that it doesn't. Crosswalks are more effective because, especially with the crosswalks changing surfaces, so it's not just striped, it would be maybe changed into brick or something like that. That is also a really effective way of signaling people that there are things going on. Even if people aren't walking, it seems, oh, people must walk here a lot because mm-hmm. there's crosswalks. And so that often will pop out a lot. So that there's more of that happening in this one.
So can you say, I mean, I assume there would be a crosswalk at the library, there'd be a crosswalk between Whately and the post office? Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yeah, right now I think there's, in this design, there's one in front of the library, the post office, and going between the post office and Whately Inn, and then Whately Inn going across Haydenville to the southern section.
Could those be raised in some way so that they sort of work as a speed bump, but not so much that they would make people crazy?
The problem with that is plowing. We thought about that. And
you could cut out the plowing feature. Yeah, that would slow the traffic.
Yes.
I have a question about right up where the veterans memorial is right now. That is a vast space of asphalt right now. You know what I mean? Because it's an intersection with Westbrook, Haydenville.
Okay, so where it exists right now?
Yeah, in fact, there used to be a cupola there in the middle, mm-hmm. Which is no longer. So that is a space that's really wide, and I'm just wondering, rule-wise, I often imagined that if the park itself bumped out just a tiny bit there, it would have a traffic calming effect, but it's still very wide there because of that intersection.
Interesting.
And I'm just wondering if that's, if that would fit the rules, because it's, you know what I mean?
Something we haven't thought about, something that I really like, and we will investigate.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that it could certainly, and it would most definitely slow traffic, make that turn a lot.
Yeah.
To try to narrow that intersection is already pretty much at its minimum as far as being able to, you've got to remember the trailer trucks that need to go out of vehicles. When trailer trucks come in there, maybe the road intersection really isn't even wide enough yet to adequately accommodate trailer trucks. So I don't feel you can narrow that up anymore.
I don't mean the width, you know that, right?
Oh, no, I didn't. I thought about
that. Yeah, but I'm talking about actually...
You're talking about expanding.
Yeah, right. And probably not even that much, but it's actually just a tiny bump out here because visually, as you're driving, if you see something a little bit this way, it would still be very much... It basically would be, the road would do a little bit more like that. I mean, that looks exaggerated. But it's really more the visual than anything. Okay. Barely any bump.
You know, the designs would have to take in the trailer truck turning radius is required. That's all that.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, that makes sense.
Is there an option for saying no truck traffic through the district?
Yes.
That is because
So in this one also it looks like there are trees added in the corner of Haydenville Road and Chestnut Plain?
Yes.
And so does that mean there's a stop sign too? Or, I mean, right now everyone knows that if people come down to Chestnut Plain and they turn up to Haydenville Road rapidly. Mm-hmm. And
they should pick up speed. I know it.
So if you add the crosswalk, that seems good. But do the trees implicate a stop or? Because it seems like the sight line is even worse with the trees there.
No, the trees, in all cases, so there is a rule that there can't be any obstructions within 25 feet or so of every turn. So any tree that is planted anywhere within 25 feet would be limbed up to an appropriate height. It wouldn't be an obstruction except for a trunk.
Okay.
And they wouldn't be huge trees like the sugar maples that line it. They would be smaller. Especially because there's also power lines that run right there, they'd be smaller trees to sort of soften the space more than anything and theoretically slow down some traffic.
Mm-hmm. But as it is, you know, people can see way ahead of time, oh, there's no one there, so I can go really fast, whereas with the trees, they say, I wonder if somebody's. So I think that's the idea, right?
You
can't plan ahead to go that fast.
Closing it in so there's not as much ability to see.
Preference, I'd rather see the veterans' memorials stay right out here.
Okay.
But also, the fact on the parking, you don't have much going on during the day, and that's when you get the speeding. Mm-hmm. And so, how are you going to cut down on the speeding? Because you aren't going to have the traffic parked alongside the road because there won't be things going on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I would be very concerned about what just took place on Memorial Day weekend. If you move the Veterans Mall and the Central School were sold, we wouldn't have, to me, enough room to have our historical events that take place twice a year. The Memorial Day has the band and lots of people out here.
Yeah.
And it seems like that's going to be eliminated to a very small space at the library.
We're playing with a couple of different options of how we've been asked to move the memorial in some way to provide more space for people to be there. And so we're playing with different ways of directing it out in this space so that people aren't, in order to see the memorial, they're not spilling out into the road. That is what it, and we have a witness, we weren't here on Sunday, so we didn't actually see how it is usually configured. So we're playing with different ways of doing it, and our only thought up here being that if it's configured so that it's facing, this general direction, having large green space spilling out into the trees and all the way to the parking lot would still provide a good number of spaces, but it may not be
the case. It would not adequately satisfy me because there's that slope.
Okay.
And we had, you know, dozens and dozens of people at this event this weekend. And
what's the fact that, to me, it's more prominent there. You put it down by the library, and to me, it's not as visible.
I really think I have to give up the historical event because I can't see where it would happen.
Okay.
I mean, we have a lot of space at the center school right now.
And would it happen behind the library?
No, there's not. I don't think so. I just think that would ruin.
You have to turn more of the land that's presently used for hayland would have to be converted into maintained grassland.
Delia, that sounds like you're commenting on two different things. Is that like one is the sale of the potential sale of the center school, and the other is the moving of the memorial?
It's all in it works together.
Yeah.
Because I see historically the Historic Society's event Memorial Day and the parade. If we didn't have this space and that space, I don't see how the library space can absorb the two of them, that's all. I'm just saying, future, I won't have to worry about it, but I think it would impact my feeling for this historic center of my town.
Yeah, and I don't know anything about sort of what is happening with center school. We just heard that.
I know, but that's on my mind.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I like a couple of things about this. I don't like littering the whole center of town with parking lots, so I hadn't proposed that. So if we can really do it with the slope and the septic systems and all, and I know you spent a lot of time talking with Keith and looking at other sources about the property, I mean, extending slightly behind the town hall and expanding the library lot slightly seems to me better than adding a lot of new and different lots.
Is there ever discussion about doing lots that are not paved?
Yes, or we've most of our recommendations will probably incorporate some amount of permeable pavement. When you get into unpaved lots, it becomes harder to plow them. Mm-hmm. So trying to explore the options for permeable pavement that allows water to infiltrate, it's lower cost, a lot of different factors that make it really a viable option, but in a lot of cases, it still needs to be somewhat paved in order to continue to plow, especially if it's a heavily used space in the winter.
When they're not paved, then they can't be delineated, you can't have your lines painted on it, and that creates a lot of, you know, when one vehicle pulls in and ends up parking so that two vehicles that could have parked, now you only can park one there, you've lost. So that's one of the reasons. And also, as you mentioned, as far as maintaining them year round in the winter, they have to be, you've got to have a paved surface to plow them adequately without tearing it up on the front.
Did you have a comment?
A couple that maybe fall into a category of is it possible to think about it. It seems to me that the elimination of the dingle, as you describe it, could happen in any of these designs.
Yes.
So you put it in one, but that intersection could be made a T, that's a separate option independent of which design we're talking about.
As with all of these.
Maybe more useful if there is the parking behind the school. But I wonder, is it possible to make either or both of the intersections, Christian Lane, North Road, and Chestnut Plain, or Chestnut Plain and Haydenville three-way stops? Is there a regulation that prevents that? That would certainly moderate traffic speed.
Yes. I do not know at this point, but we write that down as to
And I would certainly want you to design something that elevates the T between Christian Lane and Chestnut Plain.
So that
right
not,
now, that's down in a vale.
Yeah, we thought about that.
That's obviously a lot of landscaping and road building, but getting that as a higher intersection point so you have better sight lines in any case, rather than being hidden in the ground, which seems to make a lot of sense. And is it prohibitive to think about burying the power lines?
That may be cost prohibitive. So that's not necessarily up to us. We can recommend it. It certainly makes certain different things easier. It makes other things harder. But ultimately, burying power lines is most often cost prohibitive, which is why most people don't do it.
Even if you're building a silo?
Yeah, I mean, because it's a hole. You're digging down deeper. There's more involved with it. There's all sorts of tubing and different things that are, yeah.
Burying the sidewalks would put a lot of burden on the homeowners because it would be their responsibility to hire contractors to put the power underground from the road to their house. And most of them now are all aerial. So that would be a big burden on every property owner.
Yeah.
Be cheap.
Yeah, we were pretty much told that. It's a great idea. It would look fabulous, but it's probably not. All right, we have maybe one more comment, and then we'll go to the next.
I have another question. You got more parking in front of Town Hall in this option by moving the Veterans Memorial. I'm wondering if instead of moving, would it be possible to move the parking in front of the affordable housing and leave the Veterans Memorial where it is?
Yes, and I think we explored that on the lots of lots option of putting parking where currently the affordable housing is, and we don't really touch.
No, I meant in front.
She's talking about in front of here.
Instead of going where the Veterans Memorial is.
That's what
the other way. Extend it to the north instead of to the south. Mm-hmm.
We have explored
it. Another question about the Veterans Memorial. I don't know where Larry is, but
he's down there.
Bob and Larry, that when you and Bob Judah first brought up the subject of the Veterans Memorial, you were talking about the possibility of reorienting it in a certain way. And I never heard what orientation. When you had something specific in mind, but this is a good time to talk about it.
This is a good transition because we do address that on this design opposed to this one. You can explain maybe better what you were thinking. Our understanding was that right now it's oriented so it's facing the road, and changing the orientation even 45 degrees so that it opens up more space towards the parking lot, and it just creates a bigger space to host events rather than being somewhat close to the road, so that if you're really congregating in front of it, you're actually spilling out into the road within 15, 20 feet.
And the idea is that when you're driving down the road, you can get a nice sight of it. You're nestled with the trees and the bushes on each side, drawing your eye to it with some benches next to it for sitting as well. And we also move the flagpole to be next to it also.
So, with that, we can continue talking about the memorial or anything else that you have thoughts on in terms of this design.
I mean, similar to the comment about the dingle, that could be done in almost any of the designs, correct?
Yes, so we tried to design three different ones that were in some ways very different. Like, this parking is not existing over here. It can all be mixed and matched. So we're really trying to take what you do like from all three of the designs and combine them into one. Getting rid of the dingle effect, everyone loves that. That can go in the design just because it's not. We're not going to take this and run with just this one. It's going to be a combination.
So a topic we haven't asked you to address: there is a water line on the east side of the road. Mm-hmm. It runs parallel to the road. Have you figured out how you'll avoid major changes to where the water line is? Is it so deep that it doesn't matter? Or is it, would any of what you're doing, particularly here, require movement of the water line?
Not as of the moment. And again, that'll sort of depend, but at this point it's deep enough to where any infiltration basins that we're proposing don't affect it. The infiltration basins, depending, we've done a lot of calculations, Susan specifically, around how much water needs to be captured, and
we can do them with basins that are only a foot deep, so that could bring, I mean, if we have to worry about the distance of the pipe to the surface for frost, we'll have to check that and make sure we can do it in those areas, but certainly we're not proposing any deep excavations in our designs as they are now.
I like how the sidewalk extends across the parking lot in this design. In front of town.
Which one?
Oh,
in front
yeah,
of
town hall and post office.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm not a fan of the angled parking by the library because I feel like it's just people are going to have accidents because whichever way you're coming, you're going to go back the same way, so half the time you have to make a U-turn. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we can see a lot of people looping through the post office parking lot. More than we have now.
Saw another hand to work.
I did.
Yeah.
I work at the post office, and so I'm between the post office and town hall.
Mm-hmm.
We have our truck that has to pull in. He backs up
mm-hmm.
and drops all of the mail through a 3-foot door
okay.
between those two buildings.
That's good to know.
Okay, mail truck goes there, so it's not just people picking up.
Absolutely.
Okay.
And that happens regularly. At about 5:15 every day,
okay.
Also in the morning. So, and just FYI, it is like a wind tunnel through there, and all of the snow comes off. It's very dangerous in the winter there for anybody to park.
Would it ever make sense from town hall roof? Would it make sense to put all of that on the other side of the post office? Yeah, because like, see, they have the drive coming down this way and parking here. Would it ever make sense to put it on the other side of the post office so it's not under the roof?
Then you would have to park in the driveway and load.
Yeah.
They'd have to figure out whose spot to put the mail.
Well, I'm just wondering because it looks like this would be kind of analogous to the road where it is now on this side. You know what I mean?
Well, what
see how that is over there?
One issue is what happens to town hall if the refurbishment goes through, then the accessible entrance and the lift would be on the back, and so that's the natural passageway through there,
right.
And the parking loop around. It's also contemplated that there'll be better snow guards on the roof
yes.
if that happens. But of course,
right now our truck goes through there to drop the mail on the natural path. And it's a tight squeeze.
It's
not a big space.
No.
You were daring enough to propose on one of the designs that the town might buy some additional land for parking. I wonder if you considered widening the parking for the library rather than lengthening it. If you widened it between pressing towards the library and perhaps acquiring some land to the north, could you make the library parking lot wide enough to be parking left and right, so it's a double row of parking spaces rather than a long single row of parking?
We wouldn't want to push it too far this way because this gets used as an event space and that there are the beautiful views, but yeah, if it was widened this way, I mean, this, as it's shown, is 20 feet wide.
North, south.
Right. We'd only need another 20 feet to do that. So.
You're already on the property line with Eric, though. I mean,
well, that's what he said. He advised him to say.
Yeah, I realize that, but I don't. Then Eric would have to totally revamp their driveway and put it in.
Yeah, there is that.
Because you're already sharing the driveway as it enters is already half Eric and half town.
Right.
And then when it goes up and gets there, it splits, as you can see in
right,
the picture.
Exactly.
So at the road, the driveway, when you pull in, is half Eric and half Whately.
Mm-hmm.
a field out in back of the library. Mm-hmm. Is there a possibility that we could extend out onto that?
It's like 8 feet long.
Yeah, so in the designs, we've extended enough to have 3 additional parking spaces. And we've talked a lot about how far, feasibly it's fairly flat enough to extend a good ways, but it takes away some of the hayfield and it also takes away a lot of that view. So a lot of people have talked about the view out behind the library being there.
If you're sitting in the gazebo and you want to look at Mount Sugarloaf, you're going to be looking at cars.
It would be that high then.
Yeah, so we've extended it sort of at this point as far as we are, without infringing upon that view. It gets another 3 spaces, but...
We've got some vegetation here to shield the cars, but once you start getting out there...
What about the access on the way up? Like, along, because this is, so it would be basically like that. So it would be
right. Way might be able to fit a couple spaces in there. The tricky part here is that we can't really get sidewalk between here. Well, actually we can because the library is town land, so we could move the sidewalk up this way. We'd have to cross both driveways though. So we could put a couple spots in there.
I like the idea of being able to add parking at the library that isn't such a big thing, because during the day, and a lot of evenings, there doesn't fill up in the parking spaces. It's just when there's an event that lots of people are coming to. So it doesn't seem like it makes sense to add so much parking just for those events that happen. Not that.
I mean, that goes to the options for non-paved parking. If you did reinforced turf that looked like grass all the time and the events don't happen in wintertime so that you don't have to plow it, we could expand parking using turf, knowing that A, it's not going to see a lot of use because it can't withstand that without killing the grass, and B, you're not going to have to plow it, which will kill the grass. But if those two requirements are met, then that opportunity does present itself.
It's probably more use in the winter than in summer.
Okay. But yeah, then that's not probably going to be as suitable then. More questions and comments on this one?
Shall I move to the big one?
There's one other thing I wanted to point out on this one that didn't get made clear in the presentation. This one is designed so that the sidewalk goes all the way up, crosses over, and goes all the way down, and then it would go down also down to the church, and we could get like a mile-long walking loop that way. But part of the reason we did this crosswalk here in this design was because getting rid of the dingle makes it safer to put a crosswalk there. But I know that based on what Keith said about semi-truck trailers having to make it down this road, that as it's designed, it might be too tight. So is this a semi-truck intersection as well that would have to be accommodating that traffic? Okay, so that's good to know. Thank you.
So your thoughts and comments on a wide variety of parking really proposed in this last. And so that people do know, we have said that this will go until 8:15. It is currently 8:15. If you feel as though you would like to leave, please do so. We will continue to talk and be here if you would like to stay.
Can I just go back and ask the big trucks? I understand about the big trucks. Mm-hmm. But the big trucks can turn at Swamp Road, right?
Right.
That's a pretty gentle turn. Is it literally required by law that we have allowed the big trucks to turn? I mean, they're 40 feet from each other, those two intersections, and they go to the same road.
Yeah, that you're not going to be able to create a map inventory, so to speak, where people driving the road, just like if you're in a car and you decide to take Swamp Road versus, I mean, it's...
Right, you'd have to do a lot of stuff.
If you don't provide, you're going to create more of a hazard.
Yeah, I understand.
By having trailer trucks still use the road that aren't adequately designed for them, and then they're going to be causing accidents because of it.
So your objection is practical, it's not by code or legal?
And especially in this day and age, we have a lot of problems where GPS nowadays gets us into problems because the GPS is taking vehicles where roads really aren't even designed for them in period. So truck exclusions, we can't eliminate it. Also, we have, as far as this section of Chestnut Plain Road and Christian Lane, the classification in the state of those roads are major collectors. And so we have to, there'll be extensive criteria involved in doing any modifications on Chestnut Plain and Christian Lane as far as the fact that they're considered major collectors. That's the road classification in the state.
I have a question of if the elimination of the dingle, which intrigues me, does that mean the water has to be changed and the road has to be brought, all that fill? It sounds like it's a big expense.
There's a problem here because what you're talking about as a dingle, I don't think is a dingle. What they're talking about is the space of land right outside the center school. They're not talking about where the water is.
Oh, they don't mean the dingle.
They don't mean the dingle. Oh. They mean the triangle.
The triangle.
So, yeah, so the dingle is...
That's a big difference.
Okay. So, so the dingle is as you go up north to North Street, there's a dramatic drop and a little stream. That's the dingle. The triangle is that space of land that,
okay, all right, that makes sense. We always thought that was explained as the dingle. Yes.
Because more stream has to get to...
Yeah. Well, it's, so what they're describing is basically merging the triangle with the center school property so that you go around as a T. That's what they're talking about.
I think there's going to have to be a lot of fill from North Street to Chestnut.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. I'm just saying, has anyone taken into consideration the expense?
Well, I'm not sure about the fill because North Street just comes and turns into this, right?
Yeah.
So we would just eliminate this as road.
But yeah, North Street goes way down to the bridge and then comes back up.
This is a funny curve right now because you go, you have that and then you have kind of that. So it would be a funny.
Okay, because this is very close to what exists right here. It's just widened a little bit. So I'm not clear on if we delete this and leave this pretty much as it is, instead of make it a little bit wider, where's the filling have to be?
The section you just ran your pen on going east-west.
It goes down quite a bit.
It goes down about 25 feet.
Okay.
So the
trucks would be going downhill.
Got it.
To the next stop.
So this is a safety stopping concern.
And climbing back up the hill. And that was where I said I propose you raise it, but then to raise it you've got to fill it. And
right,
you've got to figure out how to
navigate. I understand now. Thank
That's
you.
Where you have to take your vertical design into combination.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, I mean there would be, and we sort of stated that one of the cons of this whole design right here is that there's a lot of incurred costs, both eliminating the road itself and bringing everything up to we came up with this just because we thought it was a fun idea.
So check the costs, you might be able to curl towards the south rather than going straight T in and find a contour that doesn't take you as far down.
Right.
Yeah, this is a drastic change, but we felt that it may address part of the root cause of people speeding onto this road is that gentle curve where you can just fly around.
And the need to merge right there, which I still consistently did.
More thoughts?
You're about to say something.
Oh,
looking at you.
In regards to, I could make this comment on any of them, but I'll do it on lots of lots. My feeling, if we're going to look at additional parking along the road, that it would be best to do it where the town, so to speak, is the frontage owners, like the library. Mm-hmm. Doing it in other sections of town where, even though the land is technically within the town's layout, you're more or less affecting individual property owners by taking away their property. And then you have the additional things that would go along with parking, is additional litter, things of that nature that will be on those individual property owners. So that's why I feel having the parking out in front of the library, if you're going to have parking along the street, do it in front of the library or do it in front of the affordable housing piece of property. Expand those areas versus expanding on private property owners.
But it would stay grassed in just the same. Mm-hmm. I mean, we wouldn't be putting concrete in
after
that would spoil the whole center.
But you've got to plow.
Pardon me?
It's got to be plowed.
I understand that, but I think I think that would take away from the whole center of town.
It's going to change the look, but you also got to remember that right now the most the area of town that in the center of town that gets the most parking in the grass, on the grass, and is the hardest to maintain is in front of the library. Mm-hmm. That section has cars parked there. Seems like weekly. There's something that goes on many times that people park on that grass. We can't keep grass growing there because it just gets driven on too much and dies.
And it seems like there would be ways to make, I mean, first of all, they're just closer, but the lot right next to the library would continue to be more attractive. People would rather park up right next to the library. So when that lot wasn't full, those spaces that would be down on the road would be empty, and it wouldn't look that different than it does now. And so it would be just when there's those overflow events where we already are looking at the cars on the road. It just seems like it wouldn't be that much of a change, particularly if it were landscaped well, so that those spots didn't just feel like the road just got wider.
Yeah, that's where the suggestion for those lots came from, is that if it's already used as parking on occasion, might as well pave it so that you can take care of it, you're not having to worry about grass dying and so forth.
Why not parallel parking instead of just angled parking?
It allows more space, more space.
But it is
higher
an
density.
It is an option. You just use some spots.
Yeah, it's hard to see on
this one.
Turn
around and all that.
This is parallel right there.
How many spots would fit there if it was parallel?
I'm sorry?
How many spots would fit there if it was parallel?
It's 7 spots. Probably could cram a couple more, but it gets really close to the foam pole, so it'd be do some more detailed measurements to be sure.
So parallel or perpendicular?
That's parallel. Perpendicular parking, we can fit 8 spots plus a break. The zoning laws are such that if you have more than 6 spots in one parking area, then you have to treat it differently, and you can't pull out onto a road.
That was a question, I'm not sure that's a given.
I think there's still some questions for zoning about that we'll have to pursue
once
we narrow it on a design.
But you're saying parallel diagonal parking effectively gives you only one more space?
Yeah.
If you break it up.
If you break it up.
If the 6-spot thing isn't actually part of the bylaws, then you could add an additional 2 or 3 spots. Mm-hmm. So it would give you 10 to 11 opposed to 7. You're going back and forth between 3 or 4 spots.
It's somewhat comparable because the head-in parking lot spots can't be where the foam poles are. The parallel somewhat can, but it also will depend on how much landscaping you want to do to make it so that it doesn't look like a sea of pavement. So there's going to be some trade-off there.
I think with the diagonal, you can actually break it up more so it looks...
Potentially.
Yeah, which is, I think, what happened in this design. Both parking with some space in between the parking so that it's not just pavement.
And help me, because I really never thought about this. If it's parallel parking, it's X feet wide and diagonal is what? How much wider is diagonal parking then?
As far as in from the road?
Extra pavement. Depth of pavement.
I'm trying to remember. I think the diagonal is
from the side of the road, you have to go in like 24 feet to the end of the spot, but that's on a diagonal, so it's at least two or three times as much pavement, because the parallel parking only has to be 8 feet wide, probably plus a little bit for, you know, getting out of the car and stuff.
So yeah, it would be 10 feet in opposed to around 20 feet in.
And so, I'm not sure I quite understand. So what we're talking about is twice as much pavement for two more slots?
Depending on how it's broken up. If it continues to be this way, where you're breaking it up with shrubs mm-hmm. or trees or whatever, mm-hmm. then yes, you're getting an additional two spots. If this isn't there, this was put in based on zoning bylaws, and that if it's six or more, you can't actually legally back up, and that could or could not be the case. You could have an additional two or three.
Could your breaks between sets of parking be the basins? So that you have a basin at the north, you could put another four spaces where that basin is, and have smaller basins between the groups of four?
Potentially.
Yeah, that could be used as part of a basin. One of the key things with detention basins is that during large storm events, in case they would overflow, we want to have access to an existing catch basin in the stormwater sewer. So they have to be connected somehow, so we might have to make a channel around the edge of the parking to get there. But certainly that space could be used as part of the area to keep the detention basin shallow rather than having to make it deep.
Susan and Warren, what else do you need from this group to go off and revise everything? Since we know you're not finished yet.
I think we got a lot of really good information already.
Yeah, and I think if you've all written down on the back of those papers, if there's anything that you still have, if you feel as though you need to go, we'll probably cut the formal side of it. We'll stick around if you want to talk or have more questions for another 5 or 10 minutes. But if there's things we didn't get to, please write it down so that we can take it with us. But otherwise, I think it's around 8:30, and we might be needing to go.
If you wrote stuff down on the map, but you still want to keep a copy of the map, I have extra, so please do hand in your comments. We would like to get them. I'll be happy to give you a blank map to take home.